Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, WrestleZone would like to welcome you to tonight's live event. Before we begin, please be advised that all WrestleZone stars are professionally trained, so please do not copy or imitate anything you see here tonight. Please also be aware that WrestleZone is proud to provide entertainment suitable for all ages, and we ask that you refrain from using any inappropriate language this evening.
Welcome to the WrestleZone podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I'm here to give you the recap of WrestleZone's Battle of the Nations event that took place this past Saturday at the Station Hotel in Aberdeen. It was a big night for WrestleZone with title changes and just some shenanigans going on that hopefully I'll get you up to date with, and hopefully you'll be there in Inverurie. So, what happened? I'm here to tell you. So, Battle of the Nations event at Station Hotel in Aberdeen on August 5th. Was returned to Station Hotel for the first time since the start of the year, when there was title changes aplenty on that show, and turns and twists at WrestleZone. No changes here when it comes to their return in August. And the VIP ticket holder match outfit, Ted O'Keefe, Murphy and Dino, defeated Oliver Green, Tommy Raiden and Air Miles by pinfall. And to be honest, it was absolute clinic from the outfit. They dominated their opponents, showing their chemistry, showing how well they work as a team. And they put him away eventually with a choke slam powerbomb combination that was it. Dispatched of Oliver Green, Tommy Raiden and Air Miles in very quick fashion. Just showing how well they are as a team. And like I said, they just dominated that particular match. Onto the main show though, WrestleZone Tag Team Championships were on the line when the Foundation of the Future, Ryan Riley and Bruiser Brad Evans, defeated Connor Malloy and Bingo Balance by pinfall to retain. Now, this is where the intrigue started on this particular show. So after a hard-fought victory, Bingo Balance and Connor Malloy were game. They had to rework their maneuvers, their moveset, because of the low ceiling at the Station Hotel. But eventually, Bruiser Brad and Ryan Riley were able to use their power game to eventually win. They got on the microphone and said that they had beaten every tag team. They went through the list of teams before eventually settling on saying that the outfit were no match for them, or words to that effect. Out came the outfit. The outfit were not too happy about that, and it led to led to the outfit backing away the Foundation of the Future as they left the hall at the Station Hotel. So it looks like we're going to possibly get the outfit and the Foundation of the Future colliding very, very soon, but we'll see how that story develops as it goes along. After that match, Captain Al Sterling defeated Deacon Matthews. This had a little bit of everything. To be honest, it had a little bit of everything. It had a dance-off, it had some shenanigans, it had some twists, it had some moves. Deacon Matthews was there for a little bit of fun until the party was over, and he decided that he needed to dispatch off Captain Al Sterling. But the captain, he did everything he could. He took any shortcut he could find, and eventually rolled up Deacon Matthews for the pin, and was able to my apologies, Captain Allen, you didn't roll him up. You hit to your hammerlock DDT for the win. But again, Captain Allen, he can prove he is a buffoon at times, but he can wrestle. He's a very talented wrestler. He's got his mixed martial arts background. He knows how to do it in the ring. Deacon Matthews possibly underestimated Captain Allen and wanted to have a little bit of fun, and he's his official singles debut in WrestleZone. But you can't go against a wily veteran with just some dance moves. You've got to actually prepare for your opponent, and possibly that was Deacon Matthews' downfall. I wanted to concentrate more on dancing than actually fighting. But that's not for me to say. Possibly we'll see Deacon Matthews back in WrestleZone. I hope so. He was a very, very enthusiastic competitor. Very colourful. A lot of his merchandise were being sold around the hall. I was seeing slinkies, smiley face stickers, and all that kind of good stuff. So hopefully we'll see Deacon Matthews back up in the Northeast in the near future. But we'll find out what Captain Allen's next target is a little later on. In a blindfold match, Damien defeated Ronan King by pinfall. And then this was not without controversy. During the match, referee Mike Yanis was knocked down, which saw Ronan King remove his blindfold, his mask, and try to gain an advantage over Damien. although it was not to be. Once Ronan put the mask back on, Damian was able to nab him with a codebreaker. I was able to get the pinfall victory. So it just goes to prove that Ronan knows a lot. Ronan's very talented. 19-year-old wrestler, probably one of the best 19-year-old wrestlers going right now in wrestling and just in general. But it means nothing over experience. Damian, even though he was blindfolded, he had one eye as well. So even if he could somehow see through that mask, that blindfold, he was still only operating with one eye. He was able to dictate his way around the ring, thanks to fans in attendance as well. They were also very much a great help, but he was able to navigate his way around the ring and gain the victory. Highlights include Ronan King doing a frog splash to nothing because of Damian's bouncing. He was able to stamp around the ring to try and discombobulate Ronan King. We had that. We had a little pre-fight before the masks were even put on. It was just a wild match for Damian and Ronan King. And whether this is the end of this current chapter, possibly, perhaps, we'll see. But after the match, Captain Al Sterling appeared on the screen and challenged Damian to a match at Halloween Hijinks because he says, Captain Allen says, that Damian looks like a pirate and he will not have pirates in WrestleZone. So, you know, that's sound logic if there ever is one by a Captain Allen. And that's where we're getting, hopefully, it has not been officially announced as yet, but hopefully we'll get that Halloween Hijinks. We'll get Captain Allen, Sterling, and Damian because they have a big lot of history from tag team championships way back when, where the Sterling brothers were feuding with Damian. From Sterling Oil with Damian and the Sterling brothers, Captain Al being included in there. They have a lot of backstory, back history that we may be able to get to explore if they have a match and maybe have an ongoing rivalry for the rest of the year. So it'll be very interesting to see how that goes and see where we go from that. After that, in the WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship match, this was so as after the interval, Caleb Valhalla defeated Zach Dynamite to win the WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship, which the place is unglued. Station Hotel, it's an old building, possibly a listed building. They probably have to go check it for subsidence or some cracks in the roof because the place went wild when Caleb Valhalla finally was able to get Zach Dynamite down for a three count. This was not without controversy. During the match, Zach Dynamite tried everything. These two went hammer and tong. At one point, Caleb Valhalla speared Zach Dynamite through the ropes to the floor. And this is there's no pretty mats at the Station Hotel. It's carpet and tiles and wood. That's your three options for the flooring outside the ring at the Station Hotel. So we had all that. They went at each other. There was kill shots. There was attempts at hell rides. There was everything you could possibly think of these two put into this match. And it was possibly a high contender for a match of the year, a match of the night, match of the year, match of the decade. It was fantastic. But as Zach Dynamite was struggling, he couldn't put Caleb Valhalla away, called for his boys to come out with Bruiser Brad and Ryan Riley. Out they came, and they were quickly followed by Dino and Murphy, and they had a scrap around the ringside. Zach Dynamite went to use the Tri-Counties Championship until Ted O'Keefe ran out from the toilet end. Just point that out there. From the toilet end, and he grabbed the Tri-Counties Championship away from Zach Dynamite, which gave Caleb all the time he needed to finally finish off Zach Dynamite with the Hell Ride. Absolute phenomenal match, and we're going to see, looks like we're definitely seeing the outfit and the foundation of the future clash at some point. Again, not announced as yet whether we're going to see some matches at Inverurie on September 9th, or we're going to have to wait until Halloween Hijinks to see the next chapter in the story. I don't know, but this is going to be very interesting to see two big factions, the two factions going in WrestleZone right now and go at it. And it's going to be a lot of big lads battering each other, which, you know, can't say no to that. That's a prospect that we'll absolutely take when it comes to WrestleZone. It's definitely been a trio or tag team match that I've wanted to see in WrestleZone. So I'm excited to see where they go with it. So congratulations to Caleb Valhalla. Next up was the 2-on-1 handicap match with Brian Tucker with Rhys Dawkins, defied the odds when he defeated Omar Mohamed in Mr. WrestleZone. And there was a lot of controversy for this one. which there was controversy afoot on this particular show, Battle of the Nations on August 5th. There was, yeah, shenanigans, we'll say that. Brian Tucker and Mr. WrestleZone didn't really have as much chemistry as you'd hope. At some point, they were both perched on opposite corners, stuck with the roof being so low. We had that. We had Reese Dawkins trying to get himself involved a turn. We had Omar Muhammad just watching on, confused and bemusement and just bafflement of the ongoings. Mr. WrestleZone had his elongated tag rope to hand, but he didn't actually have to use it. But it all came down to Reese Dawkins getting himself involved again and again for Mr. WrestleZone to try and chase him out, which allowed a distraction long enough for Brian Tucker to pick up Reese Dawkins' book and smash Omar Muhammad in the face with it, which caused the downfall of the duo for Brian Tucker to pick up the win. After the match, when Mr. WrestleZone returned, he was struck by Reese Dawkins' cast. So this thing that's going on with Brian Tucker thinking that Mr. WrestleZone is Scotty Swift is still ongoing. It's still not concluded. We don't know what Brian Tucker did achieve in this match. He was able to unmask Mr. WrestleZone. Unfortunately, Mr. WrestleZone wears two masks, because of course he does, and we're unable to find out if Scotty Swift was in fact under that mask. There's no evidence to say he is. There's no evidence to say he isn't. We're still in the dark about all of this. I apologize. There is evidence to say there isn't, because Scotty Swift was able to pass the lie detector test, which Brian Tucker revealed that he knows himself. He is a Wally. So it was. We don't know how this is going. We still have no conclusion of the investigation. We'll have to see if this kind of pans out or goes any further. Inverurie or Halloween hijinks on October 21st. We'll have to see where we go from there. And in the main event, it was Undisputed WrestleZone Championship, where Lost Boy Aspen retained against Mickey Vago to stay as Undisputed WrestleZone Champion. Again, this whole show had a lot of controversy to hand, because in the main up and in the final pinfall, Mickey Vago got his foot on the ropes to much to the shouting of the crowd. The referees came back out. Dennis Law being the head referee of the match. Mickey Innes. I came out to advise that there was a foot on the ropes. And Mr. P declared that the match would restart. There would be a rematch. Couple of words there somewhere. There would be a rematch coming at Halloween Hijinks between Mickey Vago and Lost by Aspen over the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship. So the interesting development in this particular match was the crowd. The Lost by Aspen, big favourite since he returned out in the darkness at Summerhill Hotel. And from that point onwards, he's done what he said he's going to do. He's become the champion. He won the Regal Rumble. He did all that. But when Mickey Vago came out, the crowd were more on his side than they were Lost by Aspen. They were definitely on the side of the heavy metal hooligan. There was pockets of Aspen fans, of course. You're looking at one. There was pockets of Aspen fans, but it seemed to be that the crowd were looking for a Mickey Vago win. The former tag team champion, tri-couch champion, going for the triple crown, to make it only the second triple crown winner in WrestleZone. So that was very interesting. And the fact that referees didn't get involved in any other matches, didn't get involved when Brian Tucker used the Shakespeare book illegally, used a foreign object, didn't get involved when the Foundation of the Future tried to get involved, and the Outfit tried to get involved in the Tri-Couch Championship match. But this was the match that they tried to muscle in on. Very interesting to see how that'll go. It didn't get involved with, I mean, I suppose for the blindfold match, Ronan King removed the mask, but he didn't win the match ultimately. So, you know, the interference didn't hamper the match like it did for the handicap match, you know? So it's just very interesting to see how that develops in WrestleZone, to see if Aspen starts to resent management because of their interference, their interference in his matches. Because at the end of the day, all he's doing is pinning. And if the referee counts to three, that's the match over. So, yeah, it's going to be intriguing to see how this goes in the remain-up or the build-up for Halloween Hijinks, when we see Mickey Vago and Aspen collide again for the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship. But that's it. That's your recap. Very quick one. Just what do want to keep you hanging. If you don't not keeping up to date on WrestleZone socials, because they have the full results. If you go to our own website, swsscotland.com, we have all the results there as well. We'll have a write-up soon on the website. We'll also have a road trip episode for the SWN podcast coming up soon. I think it'll be the 18th that'll go out of August, just because of scheduling. But there's plenty coming up for this show, and I'm looking forward to being at Inverurie. I'm hoping to possibly grab some WrestleZone superstars, and we'll get some interviews for either this podcast or for the SWN podcast. But for now, hope you've enjoyed the show. If you did go, hopefully I'll see you in Verurie, or I'll see you at Halloween Hijinks. If not, Christmas Chaos, it's fine. We'll see each other sometime. So I hope you have a good one, and have a good rest of the day.